Big Baseball here at Creation 2013 again. With me is Tommy Green from Sleeping Giant. And we are at the HM stage, the Hard Music Stage, Green Room. And this room belongs to Tommy for the night.
I know, it's even got my name on the outside of the door. It says Green Room.
It says Green Room.
It's my Green Room. It's got my name
on it. And we have Becky from Hospitality here.
Becky from Hospitality.
Becky, can you tell Tommy, as the headliner tonight, that this is his Green Room?
This is your Green Room.
This is my Green Room?
This is your Green
Room. See, you hear that for today? It ain't yours anymore, Maxwell.
He's been hanging out in this little van and over there, and he didn't realize that he could be
here. I didn't realize I could act so much better than everyone else.
It's right before you go on. It is yours.
Oh. Okay. So wait, do I have to pay for this? Is that how this works?
Well, just going to the bathroom. He's just in the bathroom. He wasn't actually in my green room.
Your bathroom too, right?
That's my bathroom.
Well, there's a shower. I won't cut.
Thanks, bro. Just make sure. Fine. Okay.
And I try to be subtle.
It's good to know that I've got a green room. That's all. I just feel like I've really reached a point in my professional career where the Lord has decided that I need a green room to be better. The Holy Spirit moves better in my green room than in my... Can you feel it? Can you feel the anointing of God in here? Because I can.
Yeah.
And then I look outside at all the Cretans out in the field, and I'm like, I'm so glad I don't hang out with those people. The Holy Spirit is just so much better in here. It's more comfortable in here. It's a lot like the church, right? Segway! Didn't see that coming, did you? Boom, big baseball.
Yeah,
come on.
Yeah, but one thing we can say about you, Tommy, is seriously, is that you're contagious, man.
Bro.
Your passion for God is contagious.
Oh, I hope so.
So, I mean, and every show, it's like everyone, you know, that I've ever talked to always says, you know, he's just so happy.
Oh, good.
At all times.
That's
like,
good.
Whatever. Even when you're declaring against storms at festivals that are no longer in operation.
It was awesome.
It was.
Were you there?
I was there when you said that.
Because we started praying,
cool.
And that cloud opened right up, and everything shifted.
But they still chased us out of there.
And the National Guard was still yelling at us. It was awesome. That was so good.
But then they brought you back. But
it was a
shorter set, and that was not cool.
That was the will of God that day, was that we didn't play that long. That was the whole point for that scare. It wasn't actually a storm. It was just God saying, you don't get a full 45 minutes today, Tommy Green. And I was like, okay, I'll go, why? And he's like, that's for me to know. What I'm going to do is I'm going to let hell orchestrate this, like, fear thing storm, and then we're just going to shut it down, and I just need to shave a few minutes off your set time. And I was like, okay, we can do that. So really, I was in the green room meditating on the precepts of the Lord, and that's when he spoke to me. The last couple of fests, I haven't had a green room, so it's been harder for me to know what God's actually doing. So maybe, I don't know if you want to call Hospitality at some other fests and let them know that I need that if they really want the presence of God to move. Thanks. Go ahead and dial that. If you're calling Janine in the front office, just go ahead and tell her I said what's up, because she had some great peanut butter M&Ms in the front, and just ask if that was a great feature for this festival. I really appreciate that a lot. It was good. And next time if they do the Mountain Dew, just have them do the throwback Mountain Dew. It's got the better sugar in it. I'm not a fan of high fructose corn syrup, you know? It just, I find that it gets in the way of the prophetic.
It's not natural, you know? It's not God-ordained because it's man-made.
That's what I'm saying,
yeah,
bro.
Just like so many rules and regulations from the church are man-made.
Bro.
And they have nothing to do with the
Word of God. I know what you're talking about right now. I can feel it.
And I know that a lot of times, I think that your music talks about that stuff.
Yeah, man.
You know? And so, you know, what the problems that we face, and you face, and we face from those who love God, but they hate what we do.
Yeah.
And how do you address that?
More recently, I've been just asking people that speak out against different sounds or different tones or different frequencies of praise. I've just been asking them to define or go through the Psalms or go through the Word of God and describe the seven Hebrew words for praise, because I feel like when people actually understand, because for Eric would do a better job sort of explaining some of this stuff. For him, I was more of like a hippie when I got saved, really. I wasn't afraid of some of the spiritual stuff, but Eric had really been burned, I think, quite a lot by aspects of the charismatic or aspects of some of the stuff, and he really viewed a lot of the... He viewed it as emotionalism, and he didn't really trust it. He didn't trust his emotions. He didn't trust that. He didn't trust feelings. He wanted truth, you know? And in a lot of ways, it informed our whole community of what praise was. And so, for us, we fought this, like, mental battle almost, like he did, because we didn't want to give in to what we were feeling, and we had this critical nature of like, well, it's just because someone's throwing their hands up or they're weeping or whatever, it's like, well, they were suspect, you know? And so now when people, after coming through, watching my friend really radically get transformed in tenderness because of love, like he really got awakened, you know, after like watching that go down, it's been interesting, because now when I have to say, I think the Lord is really like, I think Jesus just is really cool to us, because we don't get hit up. I don't get hit up. Like, there's not a lot of people that are like, what you're doing is of the devil. Like, I don't ever have those conversations, and I don't know if it's because
they're probably just behind your back.
They're behind my back, but yeah. If they exist, you know. But a lot of times when people come with stuff like that, I talk about the seven Hebrew words for praise.
Is it one of them, like, jump hooks around?
Yeah, dude, Hallel, which is where we get the word hallelujah. Hallel Jah, like Hallel means to boast or to shine or to rave or to be clamorously foolish. And so to think that when people say hallelujah, what they're really saying is everyone boast, everyone rave, everyone be clamorously foolish right now, and it's praise. It's praise to God. So even just for us to dance around like idiots and freak out, you know, Shabbat is to shout or address in a loud tone. It's like all we do is Hallel and Shabbat, and like we Barak, which is like to bow before the Lord. It's like we give room for people to express praise. And when it's done in the right heart, it's like there's nothing like it. And so
probably Davidic worship, you know, the tabernacle. Yeah, like that kind of thing, probably, man. Probably like that.
And that's what I'm saying. It's like, yeah, I bet most people that have a hard time with metal would think that watching the Hebrews worship the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they probably thought the whole thing was demonic. It's just 10 string lyres and cymbals, and like, what are they saying? It's like, it would be way more freaky than what we do. Like, so a lot of times with any of those sort of things, I feel like it comes from a place of, and it's not, I don't say this in like the, it just comes from a place of ignorance, I think, where it's like, you're really ignorant to the fact. And I don't know if everyone's really explored how free we really are to praise God.
I think they're just taught like the one type of worship. To them, that is, and they don't understand that there's other forms.
I know, it's so interesting too, because with this, because what's interesting is Zamar is to pluck the strings of an instrument. You know, it's what most people think praise and worship is. It's just some dude playing guitar, you know, playing piano even, strings. You know, it's Zamar. That's what everybody does all the time. And it's intriguing to me, because when we started talking about the one style of worship and one style of praise, it's like, everyone can do that. That's fine. But, like, that's one aspect of this multifaceted thing that we do. And it just is, anyways, it doesn't make sense to me.
It doesn't make no sense. And there are dominant denominations out there who don't even allow any instruments.
Yeah, and that's the part where it's like, if you want to do tequila, which is to sing spontaneous praise, songs of the spirit, sing to one another psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, you know, it's like, there's a place and time for that. But to limit any of it is to limit whole parts of the community. Like, you can't live in a healthy community.
Well, it's limiting someone's response to God.
Yeah, and that's and their sound. It's like, yeah. There's people that praise God, and I'm glad they're in the marketplace. And there's people that praise God, and I'm glad they're teachers. And there's people that praise God, and I'm glad they're doctors. And there's people that praise God, and I'm glad they're lawyers. And there's people that praise God, and I'm glad they're wives and mothers at home. And there's people that praise God, and I'm glad that they're fathers at home. Or, you know, whatever it is. It's like, people, I'm glad our culture is so different, and everyone has different roles to play. And people's expressions find themselves in different ways. So I just think it really is an ignorant thing for people to do, because without realizing it, the Bible says that there are signs, wonders, and various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit. Like, that's what it says. It talks about those. That's a lot of different options. And it says that's God testifying to who Jesus is. So if we shut down one, then we shut down signs or wonders. So really only have gifts of the Holy Spirit or some other way for God to... So it's like we shut off his voice.
Of course, sometimes the gifts of the Holy Spirit are shut off, too.
Bro.
So then what are you left with?
Bro, nothing. Then you're left with, in a lot of ways, it's like, then you're just left with the stories of what he did.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
And it's okay, because the stories are powerful. Yeah. But if the stories are all we have, there's a whole bunch of people like me that really need to encounter the truth of that thing. They need to experience the Word of God. They need the Word to become flesh and live with us. And if that doesn't happen, it just becomes rules on a page, and then we're gone. So it's hard to live in freedom. It's really hard to have freedom. Like, it's easier to have limitations. It's easier to have rules, you know? But...
Which is why I think a lot of people go to certain places, because they want those limitations.
And for some people, if that's where they're safe, that's cool. And that's why we all exist.
And they think everybody should be limited.
Yeah, and then we walk all over and just... break up their party and mess it all up. Because then they're in their safe world and doing their comfortable thing. And every once in a while, God will send some little rogue Christian to come in and just upset what they thought they knew. And they have to deal with it. And so I love that God uses all sorts of different people, you know? That's cool. It's cool. Different people, different styles of prayer, different strokes for different folks, bro.
You have divine legal right to look at those situations and make them bow to the one and only name that is above every name in the earth. You have the right to tell pain and sin and sickness and fear and despair and depression. You have the right to look it in the face and say, you do not belong in my life anymore. You bow at the name that's within me. I belong to Christ Jesus. I'm at the top. I'm not at the bottom. I am the temple of the Holy Spirit. I am not an orphan anymore. So when those things confront me, I have a right now to look at them and say, you are an enemy, I will fight you and I will win. You're royal blood. You are royal blood. So don't drink their wine, lest in ignorance you drink and you fall and die. Speak hope from a clear mind, because your eyes are open. Speak hope from a clear mind, because your eyes are open. You are royalty. You're royalty. Don't drink that wine. You're royalty. Don't drink like that. It's not good for royalty to get drunk and forget who they are. Don't get drunk on the pleasures of this age, man. Get drunk on the Holy Spirit of Jesus. Fact. That's a vacation in itself. That's worth the ticket price right there. This song is called Tithemy.
That's like a faith building song. You cannot listen to that song and not have your faith built.
Yes. Yeah, Eric Gregson wrote that song. And he wrote it for Tithemy, which is the church that he pastors in Southern California. It's the name of his church. And so he wrote that song, and he brought it to me and was just like, dude, I feel like I got a song. I think Sleeping Giant could do it. And so he showed it to me, and I was like, you let me have that song. Like, you don't get that song anymore. That's our song. Like, and so Eric wrote that. In a lot of ways, the way he described it is he wanted it to be the type of song that you can say looking up at Jesus and declaring to him, this is what I think is true, but it's also because we're seated with him in heavenly places. It's also a song that when we're standing with him in intercession for the world, you can sing down to the earth as well. You know, just making declarations either way. Like, it works both ways. And that's always our favorite stuff.
It's a killer song. I think every church in America should be doing
it. I'd love to hear people just all over the world singing that song, man. That's my dream is to go.
Is there any chance that you might do sort of like an acoustic version of that? So maybe more, worship teams could pick that up.
We probably could. I mean, for the most part, it'd be kind of interesting because it's like, bah. Bah. Like, what are you gonna... So yeah, I'll hit him up because I think it'd be incredible. That song goes, man. It goes. It's a good one.
It's a killer. And Father to the Fatherless.
Yeah, man. Okay, let's talk about that one for a second. Father to the Fatherless was the last song that we recorded. Our guitarist Jeff had written that song. I hadn't recorded lyrics for it. We got to the very tail end of the recording night. It's like 2 a.m. I'm done. Like, I'm spent. And then Eric basically opened this file and was like, dude, we have one more song. And I was like, and I realized I hadn't written lyrics for it. And we had to get it done. And we had to basically send the record out like the next day. And so it was one of those moments where I was just like, we've got to do this. Like, we've got to do this song. Jeff wrote the song. It's a great song. Like, and so I was just thinking about it. And I literally wrote the lyrics in 10 minutes and just went for it. Because it was just a good, in a lot of ways, most of the songs I write tend to be for, they tend to be for someone and Jesus at the same time, like all the time. And so that one I wrote for my son Rada and for Eric's son Ford, because Eric and I both ended up having boys, which was really cool. And so in a lot of ways, it's just that thing of, I've said it before, it's just that place in my heart that goes like, I have a son now, and he's like my favorite thing. Like he's just incredible. Like it's a different deal. My daughter Marin has been one of the closest people in my life, because I had her, I was so young when we had her, and she's turning 13, and she's like, she's just precious to me. Like I would just go through hell for that kid. And we've got this insane history together, you know, just as a father and a daughter. And we just had my little baby girl like 5 weeks ago named Piper, and I look at her and she's a different deal. Like it's a different, I don't quite get how I feel when I look at her, you know, but Rada is like, he looks like me. Like he's got my features. Like I look at him and I'm like, you're my dude. And so I think about it and go like, I would never in my life give him up for anyone. Never. Like that would just never happen. Like ever.
And then there's
a God. Ever. And there's a God that would do that. And I realized that when I wrote it, I was thinking about it going like, the only thing I had in my head when I heard that song, and I remember hearing that song and thinking like, sons need fathers. Like that's the only thing I thought about in my head. And so I remember hearing that and thinking in the phrasing like, cause sons need fathers. And then I was like, oh my gosh, like I haven't written lyrics. So I started writing it about, you know, I look at my son and it's like, I can't imagine. It's like, God, why did you give up your son? And thinking that Jesus plays, the Father and the Son play such a unique role for the brokenness in our life, because the Father knows what it is to lose a child. The Father knows what it is to give up a child. For anyone that's ever had to give up a kid, abortion or adoption, like that guilt. And it's like, he knows how to identify completely with what we go through in the breakdown of relationship. And Jesus knows what it is to be a son that didn't have a father, or had a father that betrayed him, or had a father that left him, or like whatever that is. It's like, it's such a unique dynamic to think about, the Father and the Son being able to perfectly identify with all the messed up stuff that people have in their life. Like, and just thinking like, he knows how to identify with our hurt when we feel like he doesn't understand. No, he understands perfectly, because he knows what it is to give up a son for the sake of something. And he also knows what it is to be the father that lost the son, like, or had to walk from a son, or like any, it's like, it's just such an interesting thing that God would reach out to us in that way. And that's what I remember thinking, is he is a father to the fatherless, and it's because he understands. So that was kind of where that came from. And it came out in 15 minutes, wow, but it was the last song we recorded on the record. And it, yeah, just like a quick one. Some of our best songs have been that way. Yeah, good.
Across the suicide.
Dude, I love it, man. I wanted that to be our first music video. And that's just the reality that says, like, I really believe in being blessed. Like, I really want to have an amazing life. I'd love to be rich. I just would love to be blessed. Like, I think about it and go like, oh, I'd be awesome. And then I think about it and go, but I don't have a problem with bad stuff. Like, I understand when bad stuff has happened and it sucks and I fight it, but I can also see the beauty in it. But the reality of the situation is, anyone that brings a Jesus to people that doesn't require them to die, they're getting a cheap version of everything that's available, because Jesus went into death. Like there was never, like he died, dead. And anyone that doesn't take up residence with him in that place,
That's the whole point of baptism.
They're missing out. And that's
right, we're baptized into his death and then resurrected.
And it's like, you got it. Someone has to challenge a generation of people that kind of lost the ability to sacrifice. And so I think in general, the cross of suicide is literally like, it's Galatians 2. Like the life you no longer live, the life you live by the substance of this dude living inside of you. And it's like, the cross is actually the death you've been looking for. Because no other faith in the world says like, come and die. Like just come and you're dead, you're toast. Like you're over, and no one wants to do it. But the minute you do it, you enter into something so much fuller than you ever thought. And the cross is suicide, man.